Hello, good morning to all. Today we'll discuss about the milk fever, which is otherwise known as parturient paresis. And as far as this particular disease is concerned, this is a metabolic disorder which occurs most commonly in the high-producing dairy animal. And animal is more and more prone when they are kept on calcium diet during the entire gestation period. So we'll discuss about this in detail today. Parturient paralysis is the metabolic disease occurring most commonly within 72 hours after calf. And even prior to calving, this disease is also reported and may occur 1 week prior to calving. And clinically, it is characterized by hypocalcemia, general muscular weakness, circulatory collapse, and depression of consciousness. In mares, it is called as lactation tetany or eclampsia. And as far as etiology is concerned, so most important or immediate cause of this disease is the deficiency of ionized calcium in plasma pool. There is not absolute deficiency, only ionized calcium deficiency in plasma pool is responsible for the genesis of milk fever. As you all know, there is a feedback mechanism of maintenance of calcium in plasma pool. If and it is regulated by the parathormone and calcitonin hormone. In other words, you can say that the calcium level in plasma or blood is maintained by the homeostasis mechanism in which parathyroid and calcitonin hormone is involved. They are responsible. Because it is a disease of postpartum, most frequently occurs during just after calving or postpartum. Because of sudden increase in calcium demand, which is almost double than the non-lactating and pregnant women. 2 to 3 days before calving, a high amount of calcium, about 10 to 11 gram, is moved from mother to the fast-growing fetus and to the mammary gland for colostrum and milk production, about 23 gram per day shortly after calving, which is great quantity. And you all are aware, at a particular instant of time, only 10 gram of calcium is available in the plasma pool, and it is excreted about 35 gram of calcium shortly after the calving. So this makes the animal calcium negative or deficient in calcium in the plasma pool, which is responsible for the development of milk fever. Calcium plays very important role in muscles contractions. If there will be deficiency, it will lead to the reduction in the smooth muscle tone, and consequently there will be less contractility of the gastrointestinal tract and cardiovascular system. If there will be reduction in contractility of GI muscles, it will cause the retentions of fecal material in the gut or constipation and bradycardia if the cardiac muscles will be involved. bradycardia will be there. And due to reduced muscle tone in uterus, it will cause the retention of fetal membrane, metritis and endometritis. Due to reduction in sphincter tone or sphincter muscle tone at the teat, which leads to the leakage of milk and even the entrance of bacteria, which causes mastitis. So, calcium homeostasis in a 500 kg cow has been depicted in this picture, how the calcium is available in different parts of the body and what are the source of calcium supplement and how much quantity is excreted in feces or urine and even in milk or colostrum. So, by appreciating this picture, you will be able to understand how the calcium comes in the body and how the calcium goes out from the body. So, first of all, the calcium will be absorbed from the diet. About 70% of calcium is required for the production of colostrum or milk. It comes from the dietary sources. After absorption from the gut, it will be deposited in bone if there is a no milk or colostrum synthesis or no fetal growth. If there will be pregnancy and animal in gestational stage, it will require the 15 gram of calcium per day for the development of fetus. Up to 10 gram per day of calcium is excreted out through the feces and about 0.5 to 2 gram per day through the urinary losses. Extracellular calcium pool is about 10 gram and about 3 gram of calcium in plasma. And as far as excretion of calcium in milk and colostrum is concerned, about 2 gram per liter in colostrum and about 1.1 gram per liter in milk, which is about 20 to 50 gram per day. So, these are the cycle through which we can understand how the calcium comes in the body from the dietary sources and how calcium excreted out or secreted out from the body to the exterior. The blood calcium level is regulated and controlled by the parathyroid hormone and the production of 1,25-dihydroxypolic calcium from the vitamin D3. In cows, only a small amount of calcium is circulating in the blood, about 8 to 10 gram, and rest is stored in the bones and in the gut. There are two steps to start using the stored calcium. I told you in beginning about the role of parathyroid hormone, calcitonin. Parathyroid hormone stimulates the mobilization of calcium from bone to the plasma and 1,25-dihydroxycholecalciferol is responsible for the stimulation of more and more absorption of calcium from the gut. So these two hormone is responsible for the this slides represents or the regulation of blood calcium level, which I told you in beginning. So there is no need to explain it more. Now come to susceptibility or occurrence of milk fever. The incidence of clinical hypocalcemia in dairy herd is typically below 5%. While the incidence of subclinical deficiency is still close to 50%. So we can say that the subclinical condition is more dangerous than the clinical one, because subclinical condition is not easy to diagnose, and if the animal remain in such condition, there will be excessive loss of production of milk, and the economy of the dairy will be hampered. So we need to focus upon the diagnosis of subclinical stages of milk so that the production can be minimized. Cows with subclinical hypocalcemia are more vulnerable to other diseases due to increased cord liver. This stage, there is a increased cord liver secretion, which suppresses the immune system and makes the animal more vulnerable or more susceptible to the infectious diseases. 80% of milk fever occurs within 1 day of calving, and rest is the even before calving and even after the 72 hours of the calving. So most of the cases occur within 1 day of calving. Older cows are supposed to be more likely suffer from the first calving, because there is a less mobilization of calcium from the store due to decrease in sensitivity of osteoclast cells. Stages of milk fever. As I told you in earlier slide, there are three stages. Stage 1 is called a stage of excitement, and this is the subclinical stage, and it is clinically manifested as loss of appetite, nervousness, hypersensitivity, weakness, and suffering of the iron fluid. Second stage is called a stage of sternal recumbency. This is again the subclinical stage, and this is characterized by lying down with the head out of stage or laid in the flank or S-shaped curvature, you can say. Moderate depressed coordination disorder, trembling of muscles, constipation, and fast heart rate, tachycardia will be there, and animal will remain in the S-shaped of curvature or in sternal recumbency. And the stage 3 is called the stage of lateral recumbency. This stage is the clinical stage, and animal will show the following symptoms like lying flat on the ground, severely depressed, progressive loss of consciousness, comatose condition, and even death of the animal if they are not treated properly. So these are the important clinical manifestations of the disease. There are several predisposing factors. This is very important for the prevention and control point of view. Age of cow, the risk of milk fever increases by approximately 9% per lactation. That means the animal which are in multi-pairs is used to suffer more than the premature animal. High producing cows and when producing a high amount of colostrum is more susceptible. And Jersey cows are more susceptible than the Holstein cows. And diet even is also important, one of the important factors which leads to the development of milk fever. If there will be high cation diet, it will favors the milk fever development, and high anion diet is not favors the development of milk fever. So animals should be fed the anion diet to prevent the occurrence of milk fever. High estrogen level even around the calving inhibit calcium mobilization. High calcium intake during dry period reduces the ability for calcium utilization from other sources. Faster grass will inflate cows during dry period is also responsible for the milk. तो प्री डिस्पोजिंग फैक्टर इज द वन ऑफ द इम्पॉर्टेंट फैक्टर. नाउ कम टू द डायग्नोसिस. डायग्नोसिस इज वेरी वेरी इम्पॉर्टेंट एंड यू कैन वेरी वेल डायग्नोज द कंडीशन विद द हेल्प ऑफ क्लिनिकल मैनिफेस्टेशन एंड हिस्ट्री. सिंपली यू आस्क द ओनर वेदर इट इज प्रेग्नेंट इफ द कंडीशन अकर्स बिफोर द कावे. And after calving, it is very well, well defined or well explained. There is no need to ask the owner, and you will be able to understand this is the case of calcium on the basis of clinical manifestation. But some clinical stage needs to be diagnosed with the help of laboratory finding. We should go for the estimation of calcium in the plasma. So normal level of calcium is 9 mg per kg per ml of the, and if the level decreases from the normal, you can say that this is the case of hypocalcium. Now come to the treatment. Treatment is very very important because sometimes it will help into the diagnosis as well, because in absurd cases where the diagnosis, confirmatory diagnosis is not possible, calcium borogluconate or IFEX is given and animal response that certify or that can say that the animal is coming from the milk. 500 bottle you can give IV intravenous calcium borogluconate. Second dose is needed in some cases. Apart from this, if the calcium stage of excitement is also extend to the second stage of milk fever, in those conditions it is recommended to give the magnesium and calcium both together to faster recovery. Okay, and the signs of recovery are eructations, belching and defecation. If the animal shows these symptoms after giving the calcium preparation or calcium and magnesium preparation, it is supposed this confirms the cases of milk fever. Okay, prevention and control. So during the entire course of gestation till the seventh month of pregnancy, low calcium diet should be given to the animal. And DCAD, dietary cationic anionic diet. So difference, dietary cation and anion difference. So the diet should be anionic in nature to facilitate the mobilization of calcium from the bone if the need arises suddenly. Proper attention to dietary anion strength is better due to nice diet. Dietary cation anion difference forms in the anions. Balance can be determined by blood pH. The blood should be acidic in condition to mobilize the calcium from the bone. So these are the important things about the milk fever. Okay, thank you.